up to full-time. We're happy to have you here. And why don't we move into item number two, the walk-in period. Are there any walk-ins? No walk-ins. So we'll move right on to item number three, which is a one-day wine and beer license for the Taste of Scituate. Is anyone here from the Taste?
My name's Christian Dietz, live at 54 Branch Street, and I'm representing St. Luke's Episcopal Church.
Hi, Christian.
Hello.
So tell us tell us a little bit about the event. And
this is a fundraising event. It's going to be our second year doing this. We invite various restaurants and food vendors to come bring their wares to the church, food samples and so forth, and coupons, and there have been prizes, and it's used as a fundraiser for the church, and among other things, it's used to build up our ability to do outreach in the community, among other things.
Great. So, now, is it what day and time?
This would be Sunday, November 13th, and it's from 2 p.m. to 5 p.m.
Right. So it's an afternoon of there. It's not a dinner, but it's literally booths where you walk around and get a taste
correct.
Of.
Nobody really. We have some chairs, but mostly people are wandering around in the hall.
Great. And you're looking for a
1 year beer and
a one day.
One day.
One year.
1 year. That's a long taste.
Remember the last guy that tried to a 1 day beer and malt.
It's my great tasting.
Any questions or comments from the board?
Covered them all.
How about a motion?
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a 1 day wine and malt beverage license to Christian Dietz for a food tasting event, Taste of Scituate, to be held at St. Luke's Episcopal Church on Sunday, November 13th, 2011, from 2 p.m. till 5 p.m.
Second.
Second by Mr. Norton. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Best of luck.
Thank you very much.
Have a good event. Again, that's the 13th from 2 to 5 at St. Luke's, right across the street. Move on to item number four, which is another one-day wine and beer license for a fundraiser.
Good evening, gentlemen.
How are you?
Nico Fonseca, 303 Chief Justice Cushing, and Barry Finkel on 81st Parish Road.
Great.
Representing Charles Hausman, who's the original applicant. I believe my name was also added to the application, hopefully. And we are having a fundraiser for the PTO, elementary PTOs in town. We did it last year at the GAR Hall. It was a success. We're hoping to increase the size of it, so we needed a bigger space. And the Harbor Community Building, formerly Pier 44, was a great opportunity to have it this year. So that's where we're hoping to host it. We already have the building reserved. And we obviously would like to be able to serve wine and beer at the event, so we're hoping to have a license for that evening. It's December 17th this year.
And the event's going to be dinner or hors d'oeuvres?
It's basically light hors d'oeuvres, beer, wine, social mixer, essentially a pay-first party. We have a band scheduled and people.
Great. And it's a fundraiser for more than one PTO or
four elementary
all four of
PTOs.
Them.
Yeah, all proceeds will be split to the four PTOs.
Great.
What's the band?
The band is the Dons, which Harris played the party Smith. Last year. They were a great success, so very good band. Very good local band.
Take my word for it, it is, John.
Sean?
Any need for detail, do you think, or have you got that covered?
I don't think so. I mean, last year we were at the GAR Hall. We had the parking across the street at the Masonic Lodge, which we almost didn't need this year. We're hoping to increase the size of it, but the parking lot that exists there really should be fine. We don't anticipate any issues or problems. I tried to figure out the capacity of the new Harbor Community Building. But I assume it's somewhere in the range of 200 people or more, and I think that's about where we anticipate it being. I don't really see a need for one.
Mr. Murray?
Yeah, I noticed, Mr. Chair, that the motion here says to benefit Jenkins School, and I, I, I,
I guess we should, change that to say to benefit the four elementary school PTOs.
All four of them.
Okay, sure. A motion, Mr. Chair?
Please.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a one-day wine and malt beverages license to Charles Hausman for a Christmas party to benefit the four elementary school PTOs to be held on Saturday, December 17th, 2011, from 7 p.m. to 12 midnight at the Scituate Harbor Community Center. Certificate of insurance is a requirement of this one-day license.
Second.
I'd like to amend it just by adding Nico Afonseco in condition to, in addition to Charles Hausman.
Great.
Sounds good.
Second.
Second.
Mr. Harris, for the discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you very much.
There's one more. Move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a one-day entertainment license to Charles Hausman and Nico Afonseco for a Christmas party to benefit the four elementary school PTOs to be held on Saturday, December 17th, 2011. Entertainment will be provided by a band playing music indoors only from 7 p.m. to midnight.
Second.
Second by Mr. Haney. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Gentlemen, thank you.
Good luck.
That's a really nice thing you're doing. Appreciate it.
Are you selling tickets at the school or?
We'll be sending out invitations hopefully by the end of the week that will hopefully make it around and then go through the PTOs and.
Great.
Yeah, one way or another, we'll get the word out, and tickets will be probably sold through multiple places, but including online through Evite.
Great. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks. Okay, item number five, which is a discussion and vote on the Veterans Services Agreement with the Town of Hingham. And good to see our veterans out today. Thank you guys for coming. I think before we get into the discussion, I'll give a quick overview of what's going on, and then we'll take comments from the board and comments from the audience as well. What the town administrator has done, and with the board's support for the last, probably for a couple months, you've been working on it now at least, or since the governor changed the law, where we have to have a full-time agent in a town or be in some sort of regionalization with another community where there's a full-time agent available for the veterans. And we've talked about this for several months. Just a little bit of background. Before July of this year, we only had one veterans agent in town that worked 15 hours a week. In July, we hired a clerical person who supported the veterans agents as well, and she worked 15 hours a week in that department as well. What we're proposing here tonight is that we're going to join forces with Hingham and with their full-time agent, hire a part-time agent in Scituate that's going to put 20 hours a week in here, so we'll have more time as well as the clerical personnel that we have, and have access to a 35-hour full-time seasoned accomplished veterans agent in Hingham to really look at what we're doing here and see what we need to do to improve our services and really get our cases under control. The contract, I think, will go through June, so it'll just be a short-term contract with Hingham to see what how the process is going and see what our really need is. Currently, I think we have a caseload of 4 cases in the whole town of Scituate. That will probably increase as we go out and reach out more into the community to see who else has needs in terms of the veterans community. And then at that point in time, we'd be able to look at it and see what our needs are. The person that's doing it in Hingham now is, did you say he was an Iraq war veteran? Very computer savvy, understands the process, you know, really comes with a lot of experience. So we're looking forward to working with him to find out how we can improve just our process here. There's been some questions going around in terms of will people have to go to Hingham to get their services, and that will not be the case. He'll be over here as well as over there, and like I said, there'll be somebody here more hours, 33% more than there has been somebody historically here. So we'll have a part-time veterans agent here working 20 hours, and then the full-time veterans agent will be here as we need him as well. So that's what the proposal is before us. And that's what we've been discussing, and that's what we see has a lot of benefits. Have I missed anything from the board perspective?
I think another thing is that this proposal has been supported by the State Veterans Office. I don't know the formal name of it. Director of Veteran Services has completely supported this idea, because I think everybody sees that the number of hours here in Scituate is going to be increasing. And from my perspective, Mr. Chair and the rest of the board, I see it as a, we're probably likely to have more cases because more people are going to be coming back from the Middle East. And so I think everybody here wants to do the right thing by increasing the number of contact hours that we have in Scituate. And so this is going to be increasing, as you just said, from 16 to 20, plus the shared person with Scituate and Hingham who will be on site as well. So I think there's going to be a large increase in contact hours here, which is why I think this is a good idea.
I agree. And the legality of it is has been checked with town council and with the state as well, and what we're doing, you know, adheres to the governor's plan. So so that's what our plan is, to move forward tonight. I assume you guys came because you want to have some comments, so we'll open up to the floor.
I wonder if I could ask just a little clarification first, Mr. Chairman.
Sure. If you say your name and address, you can, Ed.
Edward Covell, 45 Gilson Road.
Yes.
The full-time person in Hingham is going to be spending time in Scituate. Is that a scheduled period of time? And if so, how many afternoons or mornings, whichever the other person isn't working, should we anticipate he will be here?
I don't know the exact time. I don't think we've set Wednesday afternoons, but I think it's going to be, there will be some sort of set schedule, and I think he's just able to come over probably by appointment as well.
Yeah, because we have a vacancy in the position here right now. We have to set the schedule for the new person that we hire. So based on those hours, then we'll do that and work that out.
Thank you. And the other point is that, can we know what the status of the former Veteran Service Officer is, please?
Yeah, I mean, I've got nothing but praise to say for Gary. He did a great job for all the years of service that he was here, and it was just with the changes that are going on with the position, you know, we just chose to move in another direction, and he was supportive of it, and, you know, and is moving on with his own personal stuff as well. But Gary did a wonderful job, held all of our events, you know, stellarly, and again, nothing but praise for Gary. In the back, yes, sir.
Me?
Yes.
Yeah, Bob Callahan, 56 Acorn Street. I had a question about the part-time person that you're going to hire for Scituate. Is that person going to be a veteran or just a clerk like you had?
It won't.
They have to be a veteran.
They have to be,
they
a, veteran.
Have to be a veteran.
Right.
And will that person be able to handle the, like, if somebody passes away, make arrangements to be buried in Concord, or would that have to be done through him?
No, actually this thing that I guess folks are handing out, this is the job description for our veterans agent here contains everything that's in this thing that you passed out.
So the person hired here will be doing
right.
All this.
And the agreement that's before the board tonight also says that our veterans agent here is directly responsible for doing the flags that are done in the cemeteries and the graves and everything. So yes, that's correct.
Okay.
Yes.
Steve Litchfield, 204 Country Way. I'm just curious. I understand that this, in essence, looks like sort of a training position in a way, that you're going to have a seasoned person from Hingham that can bring this new person on and kind of show them the ropes because he knows them, right? I'm just wondering if that's why you didn't consider just hiring a full-time person right now. I'm guessing also that because we don't really know the workload, we can kind of figure it out. So I guess my question is, come next June, are we going to revisit this whole thing and look at whether we should have a full-time versus remaining in a district like we're starting out?
Yeah, I think that's safe to say. I think once we see what the workload is, and if we find that the needs in the town of Scituate are for more than what we're able to give them in this joint venture here, then we'll certainly address it. It's a short-term contract. I think there's a phrase in there that within 90 days' notice, either party can disseminate. So. You know, we're right now just trying to get our hands around what we need to do and get our computer savviness up to a level that that we feel comfortable with the services are, and then we'll address it as we need to.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, sir.
Steve, if I could add to that, this first one, because we're doing it in mid-year, we're going to revisit in June or July or sometime at that time frame, but then it can be revisited every year. So that doesn't lock us in for the next X number of years. Every year, pursuant to this board, we'll be able to reassess whether this arrangement is working out or not. Because I think... I mean, as I said to Dennis, the other night, we're all trying to do the same thing here. So we'll be able to reassess this moving forward.
And it's clear that the level of service for the veterans is increasing and has been increasing for the last, you know, several months. And, you know, we really put a little bit of the burden on you guys to tell us how it's going. You know, so, and I'm sure you will. You're not a shy group of people. So if things are going good or things are going bad, you know, we look forward to your feedback.
I'd like to provide...
I think there's someone behind you that wants to speak first.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Dennis Bedoa, 805 Drive. How do we know this guy is suited for the job, this Iraqi veteran in Hingham? Shouldn't we be able to meet him? We should be interviewing him. We know what veterans ought to know.
Well, you certainly can meet him. I've read a number of articles where he's quoted in it. He seems to know what he's talking about. I've read a couple of stories where he's gotten people benefits that they haven't been able to get prior to them being in contact with him. So, you know, are you... Well, let me finish.
Question.
Let me finish. Right now, we're not asking you guys to do the interviewing process. You know, we've done it. We've done the due diligence at this point. But what we are looking for from you is feedback in terms of how it's going. We're confident that he's skilled. We're confident that he has the background to do it, and we know he has the knowledge. So at some point in time, if there are complaints about it or you think there's a problem, then we're all ears to hear it, and we'll go from there.
Once you hire the wolf, it's hard to get the wolf out of the garage.
Well, as I said a second ago, there's a clause in the contract that says any day with 90 days notice that we can terminate the contract. So I think that we're pretty confident that that with the contract the way it is, that we're really not tied in for a long period of time.
But I think we should be the ones that are asking questions of this guy.
Well, I think you will.
But that's before he gets hired.
Well, we'll agree.
You don't put the horse before the cart.
Well, we're confident that he's skilled and that he's going to be able to do what we need to do.
What do you know
about
veterans?
Yeah, what experience?
Well, we know he's been doing it in Hingham for quite a while, and we know he's been doing a good job there. And again, if this happens and you guys are uncomfortable with it, you don't think you're getting the service that you need, then I'm sure you'll make your voice very loudly known, and then we'll deal with it from there.
See, we're the old war horses. We could care less. We're not afraid of nothing. And we ain't afraid to ask questions.
We're
fearless. You don't understand. We want to know who this guy is. We want to know who we're getting here, too.
Well,
we want to be well aware of that.
Well, we haven't. We're about to post the job for here, and there'll be a whole interviewing process. I don't know, Trish. Do you want to add to?
Yeah, I spent considerable time with the veterans agent in Kansas. He's a singularly impressive individual who wants to make the most of the opportunities for the veterans and make sure that they.
Maybe he only
the
thinks
match.
That
Excuse
way
me.
In his town.
Excuse me, sir. Excuse me. He wants to ensure that he gets the maximum benefit payments. As a matter of fact, he was commended in the Boston Globe article last week for getting benefit payments to someone that didn't even live in Hingham. And when we hire the person here in Scituate, I would be more than willing to have a veteran in this community sit on the search committee to help us in that selection for the vacancy that is in here. And as soon as this agreement is signed, I will arrange to have Keith come here and meet with any veteran here that wants to meet.
Thank you.
Welcome. Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, board members, town administrator, I'm Bob McHugh. I'm a member of the Legion. I'm commander of the Sons of the American Legion. I'm senior vice commander of the Sons of the Civil War Veterans. And we're here with the commander of the Veterans of Warren IV. VFW, we've all talked, and we all feel that Scituate should have a Scituate agent 35 hours a week. Why shouldn't Hingham have the 15 hours a week? We want an agent. We're entitled. We are not contiguous with Hingham outside of some connection through the woods, which doesn't count. I talked to Senator Hedlund today. Jim Cantwell agreed with that, that it's not legal. It's not because we are not contiguous with it. We are entitled to a 35-hour veterans agent in this town. Gary Carroll did an exceptional job. Dear, dear, our guys wish you would kept him on full time. He wished that he could have done it. He would be glad to come back and offer his services for nothing to assist your next full-time Scituate resident veteran, 35-hour Scituate veteran. And he will give his time for nothing to help put this in motion. Gary, Gary brought these to my home yesterday and said that this is all I could do in the 16 or 15 hours a week, that he could have done twice that in 35 hours, and that and he regretted because there were so many veterans that were going without. We fully support a Scituate person being the veterans agent for Scituate. The state agrees with us. They say it's illegal not to have a Scituate veteran from Scituate having less than 35 hours a week. I'd like to turn this over, if I could, to Brian.
Bob, wait 1 second. Yeah. First of all, I just want to assure everybody that it is completely legal what's going on. And I think that the services that the town will be getting initially, and we're only talking about a nine-month period, actually not a nine-month period, is you're actually going to be getting 55 hours worth of service from a part-time person and a full-time person's accessibility. So if we find, as I said, after June 30th, through this kind of trial period here where we're going to get our feet wet, that the need is more than that, then we are more than willing to look at it and do what we need to do.
As Dennis said, once the wolf is in the coop, there's no getting him out.
Actually, if I can intercede here, and Bob, I've known you for a long time, so I hope you understand that that reasonable people can agree to disagree on certain aspects of this. But, you know, this wording such as once the wolf is in, I personally find distasteful, because that is a phrase. No, that's a phrasing here, you know, just all you gentlemen, okay? And because you certainly all are gentlemen. That denotes a lack of trust. It says things like, you're essentially telling us that ourselves and the town administrator don't know who to hire, and we don't know how to handle situations if they're a problem. Let me finish, please. And so we clearly have outs in this contract that protect you folks, that protect the town, that protect Hingham, and protect this relationship. So let's just put to rest right now this whole once the wolf gets in sort of incendiary wording that I don't think is really progressive and gets us where we collectively want to be. And then one last point is we have certainly checked the legality of this. And as we said earlier, it is 100% legal, and it is in fact supported by the state, I've already forgotten it.
Veterans Commission.
The State Veterans Commission. And we've also had discussions with our elected representatives in the State Senate and in the House of State Representatives. Okay, so I just want those facts to get out via the press and via everything else, because we all are trying to do the same thing here, which is to increase the services, which we're doing.
We would like this to be put on hold if you can't give us a full-time representative, as Scituate being the lead, not the sub-agent. We want to be the VSO in Scituate and have Hingham, if they want to be the sub-agent, not Scituate. Why should Marshfield, Cohasset, Hingham all have full-time agents and not Scituate? I don't understand. All right? That's baffling.
Sure.
We are deserving of it. We need it. We need the help. We need your help desperately. There's a lot more to it than what shows on in the town report. It's the, not only the veterans, but their families, and all of the good work that the veteran agent would like to do. We implore you to not vote on this, or at least, if you do vote on it, to vote a full-time, 35-hour work week for a Scituate agent.
Thanks, Bob. Mr. Cabell.
Yeah. Ed Koval at 45 Gilson Road again. Just to highlight how far in the hole we are in serving our veterans in this town, you said tonight there are four who are currently receiving benefits. The last I had heard it was three, but it's almost irrespective. The average town in the state of Massachusetts finds one veteran needing services per 1,000 citizens mm-hmm. in the town. That's six times more than we have been able to find in Scituate with a half-time agent whom we all have agreed was doing a good job.
Right.
We haven't even touched on outreach to veterans. Scituate has only responded to those who come to the office seeking help. And I can tell you that in the 3.5 years that I have been the commander of the American Legion post, many of them have resorted to coming to me because they come here in the afternoon and there's nobody home. I have expressed to several of you my concern, and it is the extreme case, of an Iraqi vet coming back who has mental issues because of what he's been through, who knocks on the door and says, I need help, but there's nobody home. He has nowhere to go.
Well,
now, I understand he will be able to get an appointment with the full-time service officer in Hingham, either here or there, whichever. But what if he doesn't make it that far? What if he only makes it to the bridge?
Well,
can I address that?
Sure.
First of all, the veterans clerk works in town hall 35 hours a week. She checks the phone messages every single morning and every single afternoon. I am very familiar with the case that you're referring to, and I personally interceded in that case. And that person was helped not only by the veterans office, but by the selectman's office and the town administrator's office. We are getting 55 hours of service a week. That full-time agent in Hingham is going to be just as available to Scituate veterans as they will, as he will be to Hingham veterans. And the 20 hours a week, the person from Scituate is here, will be here 5 days a week, and then the clerical person will check to make sure there's no messages, and if people contact that number with the answering machine, they will be referred to Hingham for immediacy, or our clerk will be able to handle them. All the concerns you have about outreach, I share, and that is why 55 hours a week as opposed to the 16 hours a week we have before are going to help address a lot of the concerns I think we both share. But the reality is we have four active claimants right now. We want to have people doing outreach, such as the new veterans agent we hire and the Hingham veterans agent, who's particularly skilled in this area, to reach out to folks, to work with you folks, and make sure these veterans get the benefits that they need.
Thank you.
In response, may I say that you and the town administrator have both said we're having 55 hours of service provided. If the full-time person who is in Hingham, serving Hingham veterans, is not going to be available during half his time, then we're not going to have 55 hours. I mean, it's an exaggeration.
Yeah, I understand your concern. Change is difficult. I think it's a change in the right direction. Is it the final course? I don't know. But I tell you what, we'll readdress it in 7 months. Hopefully we'll get the expertise of the person in Hingham who can help us with our outreach. You know, there's clear areas that we haven't done as well as we can in terms of veteran services over the last, 70 years. So I think at this point, you know, we're going to lean on him a little bit to find out what he's doing in Hingham, what we should be doing here, implement strategies, implement programs, and then address it. If we feel we're not getting the service that we need, then we'll address it. But right now, we've got someone that knows how to file the paperwork, knows what has to be done, and whoever comes on as the part-time person will be his apprentice and learn all this stuff and perhaps grow into a full-time position or not. But it will be a time period for us to really upgrade our veteran services, I think, in a lot of areas.
Final comment?
Sure.
In all due respect.
Yes.
We're about to have hundreds of new veterans return from Iraq. Secretary of Veteran Services, Coleman Nee, that is his title, is very concerned that these people find out what services and benefits are available to them. And he recognizes that the only way they'll find it is if there is a good outreach program in the town.
Mm-hmm.
And that, in my opinion, this is no time for us to be teaching an apprentice how to do outreach.
How? I don't know of another way right now. I don't know who we would hire that has the background that we would need to jump right into the position now. And again, this is a short-term situation. I think that's why the governor, you know, enacted the law that he did, and that's why we're following it and moving forward with our services. Mr. Norton.
Yes, just a comment, Mr. Chairman. You know, we were asked as selectmen, probably one of the most frequently asked questions or statements to us is, why don't you regionalize more? Why don't you and other towns get together and try to regionalize for the purpose of economizing and saving money. And it's a legitimate question that's been asked for a long time. And I think tonight what we're trying to do, at least on a trial basis till June, is to do exactly that. It was exactly what people seem to ask us for all the time. I think everyone up here would agree that's one of the primary questions, comments that people make to us in the course of a year. Too bad there wasn't more regionalization among towns. And here we are trying to do it, and I think everybody wants regionalization, except when it affects them, and then maybe it's not such a good idea. It's all right for the other person, but it's not all right for us. And I guess what we're trying to do, if this was a permanent, written in stone vote here tonight, it may be worth thinking a little further down the road or giving it some thought. But it's till June, it's 7, 8, 9 months, whatever it is. I think we'd have a pretty good feel at that time whether we need a full-time agent or not. If we do, I think I can guarantee you, just by talking to the board members and talking to the town administrator, if there is a need for a full-time agent come June, then there will be a full-time agent. No one's trying to skirt that issue at all. If this board feels that the workload is such and the agent, whoever he or she may be, comes to us and says, I just can't do it. It's overwhelming. It's too much. I can't serve the veterans in the way I want to, in the way the town wants to serve them, then I think we would be foolhardy not to listen to that person, and I'm sure we would. So that's all I just wanted.
The only thing I'd add is the reason why we're, you know, bringing a partnership together with Hingham isn't to save costs, though. Our costs are going up. We're doing it to get expertise and additional service. We're not trying to eliminate positions. We're actually adding positions. Mr. Harris.
I was just going to make a comment. I wanted to listen to see what a lot of you guys had to say. I had a nice conversation with Steve Litchfield in my office today, and what Joe was saying could very well be the case. Steve brought some issues to me that this new agent could very well work himself into a 40-hour job, but we'll wait and see. And, you know, you guys and Steve mentioned all these things that he could do. My biggest thought, thinking of all the veterans and families in the town, would be to have this agent be available 9 to 12. Whatever those hours are, at least they know that they can get someone from 9 to 12, 5 days a week. Sure. After that, like Tricia said, there'll be a phone call could be made, and a phone call could be returned, and that person could be in touch with the person in Hingham. They know the very next day, Monday through Friday, at 9 o'clock, that person will be here or will be able to get in touch with them. I think that's huge. I mean, you're going from 16 hours to 20 hours right there. You know, like Tony and everyone said, that's a big plus. For 6, 7, or 8 months, and you have to have a lot of faith in who she's going to hire, all right? She's, you know, I'm pretty impressed so far. So if you guys, and she hit the nail right on the head. I wrote a note to Joe. I said, maybe one of you guys could assist her, and then she came out with it. So I think it's a win-win situation. And if it's not ideal, like Steve and I were saying, then we'll know next spring and maybe address it then, like Joe just said. Thanks.
Bob.
Yes. Number one, the assistant is excellent. She is just a wonderful lady and very smart and very nice. But she's not a veteran. The only veteran up on your stand, I believe, is George Norton. At least he's the only one who belongs to the Legion. Are there more veterans?
No. But let me just, Bob, let me interrupt for 1 second. That clerical person is going to be there, but on top of that, there's going to be a veteran in the position for 20 hours a week.
But that doesn't count, because we're supposed to have a veteran agent for 35 hours a week. Why should we be less than Hingham or Marshfield or Cohasset or any of the surrounding towns? We shouldn't. And if anybody's going to be hired, including putting Hingham on it or whatnot, I think that it would be only fair to the veterans organizations, all of them in town, to have a representative from the veterans organizations make sure that they agree with it. Now, I personally don't think that this town should give up taking the lead as the VSO. I don't think we should give that up. 75% of the cost will be covered by the state. All right? And we're going to get 3 times as much work done with 35 hours work. Okay. Extremely important. Gary Callow thinks so.
Great. Thanks, Bob. Okay. Conway?
Connolly Ford, 19 Sylvester Road. I understand we had approximately 2,000 veterans in Scituate, is that correct? I don't know, I've heard that number out there. I mean, counting the families, that's quite a few people. And the last 4 or 5 years, we've got 4 new organizations, veterans organizations, that's been formed here in Scituate. American Legion, Sons of the American Legion, Blue Star Moms, and the Sons of Union Veterans of the Civil War. That's an activity, we're taking up a lot of this for, in other words, we're doing services that normally a veteran service officer would be handling, providing information, help, tell them where to go to, or services. Now, to me, a VSO job is whether part-time, full-time, or overtime, there's certain things that a VSO officer has to have feedback from the community. The veterans organizations, the nonprofits, we're the arms and legs that does the work for the VSO office when it comes to community affairs for other veterans, whether it's Veterans Day, Memorial Day, Flag Decoration Day, wakes or whatever for veterans in the town. We get involved, decorating graves, repairs of grave sites. So we're the arms, we're the workforce for the VSO. But what's missing is this essential element that I'd like to see the next VSO, whether part-time or shared time or full-time, that a Scituate Veterans Council be formed. Now, under the VSO, under the Mass General Law, the VSO for that town can form a Veterans Council from 5 to 15 members. That's Mass General Law. The guidelines are already there, made up of not only a veterans, some civilians on this council, and they would report to the VSO. Now this is very important, because although we're nonprofit organizations, veterans organizations, we don't the 2,000 veterans in this town don't belong to the Legion, the VFW, the American Legion, or AMVETS, or the DAV, those veterans organizations. They have no spokesperson. By having a council, we have a chance for the first time to hear from those veterans that don't belong to veterans organizations via the council to the VSO.
I think that's a great idea.
This takes the responsibility off of the selectmen, people in town government. You say, well, if you've got a question about veterans, what does the council have to say? Take that, run that through the council. Now, the council people, as I say, is made up of veterans. They could be members of organizations, church groups, or whatever.
Can I put you on hold for one quick second? I think Mr. Murray has something pertinent to say.
Yeah, Connolly, I think that's a really good idea. And in fact, I was reading through the agreement, and when earlier last couple of days, and when you were speaking, it triggered a memory in me. And I just want to read out loud from section B5 of this agreement that we'll probably be voting on tonight. And it says, the Hingham Scituate Veterans Services District shall work with local veterans councils, and that's with a capital V, capital C, so it's exactly about what you're talking, from the member communities, that's Scituate and Hingham, to assist the councils in coordinating all ceremonies, parades, and all member communities and other duties. So that sort of wording and the veterans councils is throughout here. So, I think this is exactly the sort of thing you're talking about, and that's a very good point.
I think it's imperative that we form a veterans council under reporting to the VSO. This way you can get feedback. In other words, if we had a veterans council, this whole question would have been handled via the veterans council, would be in here tonight. Not the veterans
right.
organizations. The council would be handling this. Hingham does an excellent job, their council there. An excellent job. They can do, the council gets very much involved. They provide a lot of service and they help. They actually assist the VSO officer in his or her duties. That's where I'm coming from. That I prefer a full time. I would like to see us get to a full time as soon as possible, age in this town, because believe me, we need service here. For example, in 07, give you a little back history. In 07, I talked to Secretary Kelly and his staff up there. At that time, they had 53 full-time employees, a $38 million budget at that time, and that was 07. I said, what are you folks doing? Oh, we do all this stuff. I said, really? I don't see any people coming in here for services. And I said, my biggest concern is that we have a whole different demographic now of women in the military, young women, 18, 19, 20, 23, married with children and stuff like that, that's going into the military. Through the guard system, more and more women are out there requiring specialized services. Now, you can't ask an 18 or 19-year-old soldier, female, to sit down with a senior VSO officer and talk about things that of a female nature that a man can't handle. We need to address that situation. We have that. We don't have that service. Where is it? So, I said, well, really, we need to do something about that. And I'm glad to see that there's some directors out there now that the Secretary of Veterans Services is taking care of this, addressing it. But that still has to be addressed here in Scituate. Now, you right here in Scituate, if you have a young lady from Scituate that's in the military, who does she go see? Who does she see in this town? If she's got a domestic problem, or a medical problem, or a financial problem, who does she go to? You think the person that we have, if is a male, would understand her needs? That's why we have, it's so important to have your own service officer in your own town. Rather than some come and say, well, you have to go down to Beacon Hill or so-and-so to get those services. That doesn't get it. Or you send an email to National. They'll help you with that. That's not what it's all about.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
That's where I'm coming from, and I would like to see that.
I think, are we prepared to?
Can I say one more word? And that's very good what Conley said.
You know, I'm gonna let the man in the back speak. You've spoken a couple of times, so I know you haven't spoken yet, sir. So,
Andre.
Members of the board,
just your name and address, please.
My name is Andre Farhad, Haverhide, Scituate. With the exception of Mr. Norman, how many of you are veterans?
Mr. Farhart, that's irrelevant. And in my, I actually feel, gentlemen, I know Mr. McHugh had asked the same question. We're here for this evening.
Another thing. Look around the around in the world, I witnessed the in the mid-60s, the return of the Vietnamese fighter pilots that came in. They couldn't get a job driving a taxi cab, never mind trying to fly an airplane, which gives us a scope on how many people are coming in looking for something specifically. When Vietnam closed, the country was flooded with help. I mean, there was more help than there were jobs. The same thing is going to happen in Iraq, as my brother has just stated. We're not going to get a couple of thousand. There's hundreds of thousands of soldiers in Iraq. Afghanistan, Pakistan, they're going to be coming back. We have to value these people that are making it possible for us to live the way we're living, nice and safe, and we got all the convenience anyone can have. Look at the state of Israel, 1,087 detainees for one soldier. A soldier, not a high-ranking officer, a soldier. They did the same thing in the 63 war, in the three-day war. They released the whole Third Army of Egypt, which is the biggest in the Middle East, for one general. They value their fighters. They're the ones that step between the bullets, between a robber, between a knife, to protect all of us out here, and they're doing it offshore. They're not doing it here. So when they come back, the least we can do is say thank you to them. 31 guys died a couple of weeks ago in Afghanistan. I didn't see one flag at half mast. Flag on my house was down at half mast for 31 days, every day for one soldier. I don't know these people, they don't know me. But they're my brothers and sisters too. So we would appreciate your help greatly to look at this situation.
And I know that you know that we all support the veterans as much as we possibly can.
Absolutely.
So there's no question about our support there. Okay. And we have. Okay. I think, Steve, if you have something new to say. Okay. Yes.
Steve Litchfield, Tullahoma Country Way. Joe brought up the idea of regionalization. I know that's why we can do the part-time thing and all that. But at some point, could we still stay in a region and have two full-time? I would say that would be the best of everything.
Yes.
You could come on vacations.
We could.
Share.
Sure.
I mean, just because we're in a region now on a part-time, if we find the workload, rather than dump the region and just get a full-time person, I see it would be better to do it the other way.
Yeah, and I think that's what we've been trying to say up here, that we've really got a seven-month window to figure out what our needs are and to gather expertise from Hingham, who Conley is, you know, said to have has a great program over there, and then we're going to reassess it and see where we need to go. So, and we look for your input in terms of the direction that we go, and we look for your input in terms of selecting the part-time person that we hire here.
Can
so,
I ask one other question, so I'm curious.
Sure.
A part-time person is different than a full-time job in terms of benefits and all that.
Yes.
So, if it was a full-time person, they'd probably be more motivated because.
Well, we hope whoever we hire is very motivated.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's the
15 that's... Okay. Gary Callow?
One second. This is the last comment. Yes, sir.
Bob Young, 33 Branch Street. I've just got one comment. 7 months can be an awful long time to be running a training program for somebody who's really hurting. And I totally disagree with the idea of trying to piecemeal a training program.
Hey, it's not piecemeal. Whoever we hire is going to need to be trained, period. If we hire a full-time person, they're going to have to be trained. The fact that we're getting expertise in here right off the start, I think, is a huge benefit to the partnership that we have with Hingham.
Just to say, you can't get a full-time experienced person right now. You haven't advertised.
We could, and maybe we'll find that through the interviewing process. But I think that there's a lot of benefits, and I think everyone on the board thinks that there's a lot of benefits for taking the steps that we are. Mr. Harris.
I was just going to say, this person might not need any training, just know where Town Hall is. Well, they're going to be a Scituate resident anyway. Right. They're going to know where that is. Maybe there's someone out there, you know?
Yeah, I mean, you would know better than me. Is there a veteran in Scituate right now who's been a veteran servants agent for another community?
Well, this guy from...
Bob, one second. It doesn't look like there is.
No,
so, I mean, if one of you fellows wanted to take that position on, I don't think that you understand the process yet, and I think that there's going to be, I don't know the forms that have to be filled out and the computer programs you have to learn and all of this sort of stuff that you have to do to get up to speed to be a very effective veteran service agent. And that's what we have right out of the bat. Right out of the bat, you got a very, very good qualified person in Hingham. So, any other?
My only thing I just want to add, because I spoke up a lot sort of earlier on in this discussion, but gentlemen, I think keying off something Connolly said, you know, you folks do provide a lot of the services, you're there at the parades, but you're even doing a lot of the stuff that people don't see in public, above and beyond the parades and the ceremonies. And you know, Bob and Connolly and Andre and Steve and, you know, Ed and some of you other gentlemen, Dennis, you know, we're all truly Scituate people working hard to try to do the right thing. You have to have, and I ask for some of your trust on mm-hmm. this, if this isn't working in 6 months, we're not going to want to keep it going. And if it works for 6 months, but 18 months down, and it doesn't work because there's more veterans or less veterans or whatever, every year we can reassess this, and we will. Do you honestly think that this board, if we start getting significant negative feedback, is just going to say, well, tough, that's the way it is. We want to do the right thing for the veterans. We've been doing the right thing so far, and we want to do more. And in conversations with the town administrator, we're happy with the work that's been going on so far, but we're not satisfied. We want better. We happen to think that this is a way to make it better. Now, we might be wrong. And if we're wrong, do you honestly think we're just going to stick to our guns and just, no pun intended, folks, but just stay here and just keep it going in a bad way? Of course not. We're there with you on this. This is the direction we think we should go for this short time period, and we're going to reassess. And honestly, like I said just a few seconds ago, do you really think we're not going to try to write it if this is not a good decision? But you guys have to trust us as well. And as Tony said earlier on, we're going to need your feedback with an open mind to see how this is going as well. This might work out better than you think. It might work out worse than we think. We don't know yet. But this is what we're asking for. We're asking for your trust. We're asking to move forward on this. We're increasing the number of hours, regardless of how you compartmentalize it. And this, I think, is a good way to go. And so I'd like to move ahead with a motion, unless, I mean, it's up to you.
I think Mr. Norton
what have you.
I was just going to say, Mr. Chairman, and before we, you know, we can go on, and I think we certainly understand the concerns of the veterans that are here tonight. But again, we can go back and forth. I think it's probably till midnight. So having said that, I would like to suggest a motion and see where it goes, if I may.
Yes.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to enter into an intermunicipal agreement with the town of Hingham for the purpose of creating a joint veterans district to be known as the Hingham-Scituate Veterans District, effective November 2nd, 2011, through June 30th, 2012. Renewable in subsequent years by the board in accordance with Mass General Laws, Chapter 40, Section 4.
Second.
Second by Mr. Murray. Further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Thanks for coming, and we look forward to your feedback. And I just ask you, give the guy from Hingham a chance, get to know him, and then let us go. Unfortunately, we're really done with this topic.
I just want to know one thing. That is, doesn't the veterans agent have to be trained under law? That would include anybody from Scituate applying for the VSO job. Why can't we do that? Because the state will provide the training for the veterans service officer.
To the town administrator.
Yeah. Okay. I don't know the answer to that, but we've moved.
Could you consult on that?
Sure. Thank you all.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Okay, now we'll move forward to item number 6, which is the Economic Development Committee's survey overview. Jen?
Thank you, Dennis.
Chicken coop, Dennis.
Got it, Dennis.
Guy from Vermont, you should know that.
I appreciate it.
Hi, guys.
Good night, Dennis.
Bill, how are you?
Good. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Bill Logan, 15 Cornerstone Lane, Chelsea.
Just wait one second. Just... Okay.
Yeah.
For the record, Bill Logan, 15 Cornerstone Lane, I'm a member and the chairman this year of the Economic Development Commission. I'm joined by Trish Dooling to my right and Jen Morrison to her right. Jen has been heading up our initiative with respect to the survey. Trish has been assisting her, and they're going to outline what our suggestions are to the board. I know they've met with Trisha, so we ask that you just listen quietly, and we'll try to get through this very quickly.
Quietly?
Sure.
can't promise that.
No need to. Hi. So just to give a little bit of background how we got to this point as one of the initiatives, I really pushed for it hard as a new member of the Economic Development Commission because my background in business, I'm a Six Sigma Black Belt, which just is a fancy term for a process improvement consultant. So I go into any type of business and I start, the Six Sigma is all about having the data. So you take a look at the data, you understand what it is going on with the situation, and then what is the root cause of that problem, if you will, and then what do we need to do that will fix it and keep it fixed. So it all goes back to the beginning of data. Anytime I start a new project, if you will, I say, well, where's the data? And you know, there's budgets, there's numbers, but another piece of data is understanding what are businesses thinking, you know, and you can go out and you can go ask business owners or people in Scituate. We can sit down with each of you and have an individual conversation, and that is very valuable, and I think we all intend to do that. But one of the most efficient ways of gathering a lot more data is to send a survey out. And you have these great tools nowadays and online. This website's called SurveyMonkey. I have a membership. So I pay for that each month. I've used it hundreds of times, doing different surveys for different businesses and nonprofits that I have done throughout my consulting career. So I started, you know, with that idea, but then it happened that Laura Harbottle came to one of our EDC meetings back in July, and she brought to the meeting two articles that were really outstanding, one Framingham and the other in Walpole, that they sent out surveys to their residents. So from that information, then I did some more research online and found some great surveys that were done by other towns in Massachusetts. I was really targeting Massachusetts. Went, emailed the town, some were town planners, some were town administrators. I got the actual surveys from the town of Bolton, the town of Walpole. They gave me not only the survey questions themselves, but the results. And then I also you know, have information from the town of Lowell and the Pier 44 study. Our own library did one. So a lot of research went into creating these surveys. And then from that, we also looked at, well, what are our different audiences? We want to definitely target the businesses. But from there, it's also looking at, you know, the term I use in stakeholders. Excuse me. All of you here would be stakeholders for the town of Scituate, but also people like that work on various committees. Stakeholders, you know, how long is it going to take us to have that individual conversation again? So just wanting to get out a little bit more in depth with one type of audience like yourselves, but then balancing that need with, well, geez, everyone in Scituate is a stakeholder. However, we can't ask them to sit down for, you know, 20 minutes and ask a lot of in-depth questions. So we came up with three surveys. One, to be kind of short and sweet, you know, it should take them less than 5 minutes to complete. Then one that would be what we're terming the employee, but it's also really, you know, employee slash volunteer, anyone that actually would want to fill out that survey is welcome to. and then the separate business survey. So that's the three different surveys we developed. And really, the reason, the goal of what we want to do with these surveys, there's a couple different goals. We want to just get that data. You know, we don't know what might come back, and until we have that information, it can help us guide, you know, where we can go with further initiatives to help meet the Economic Development Commission mission. And then also just kind of create that baseline. Some of the questions are really geared towards, okay, let's just ask it now, and 3 years from now, let's do a survey again, and let's ask the question again, and we can show the improvement. Because if you don't ask those questions now to get that baseline, you're never going to be able to say, I can prove to you, you know, from this actual data. You can say, I think things have improved, but in my line of work, I like to say I can show you the numbers.
Great. We've got copies of all three. We've all looked at all three. We're all pretty familiar with SurveyMonkey, so
good.
I think we're with you so far.
Awesome. And I guess what we need from here is, you know, what we're doing is proposing that the surveys would be online then for 2 weeks, and we would like just have your approval for the surveys. And I guess before I even ask for the approval, I'll ask for if there are any questions.
Yeah, I think we want to go over the content
okay.
a little bit
yeah,
of
great.
Them and probably discuss a little bit, you know, what your mission is
okay.
and how is this getting there. In some cases, we may have questions. I mean, I don't want to speak for anybody here, but that's, you know, kind of the guideline okay. of this. And then at that point, once we feel comfortable with it, we'll, yes, Mr. Norton.
Sounds good.
May I? Yeah. Just a general question. I'll have some follow-up questions. There were questions in here pertaining to the town and as well as the schools. And you're here tonight to answer the town's concerns, if there are any, on this survey. Have you contacted the schools? I mean, because there are some questions here that are pretty pointed, I think. And I'm not even sure they belong in an economic development situation, but you probably could argue that point. But working the assumption they do,
yes.
okay, which we're not quite ready to admit, but say they do, have you contacted the schools just to see if they're comfortable with them?
I'm hesitant to answer because I feel like I've been in contact with the schools, but I have not specifically asked them to approve this survey. The process what we went through, and I should have mentioned this as well, is that, you know, from developing it within the seven members on our commission, then Trish and I sat down with Tricia and really got a lot of great feedback, and I felt like it really took the surveys to the next level, and we incorporated a lot of changes.
They may have no problems. You know, they may have no problems with it at all. I'm just suggesting, I think, that it
okay.
may not be a bad idea to be a little proactive and either formally or informally run it by them and see if there's a
concern. I have informally mentioned it to
and while you're on the point, if you want to tell me what your thought is as how the schools are part of the mission of the Economic Development Committee, that may get us on that,
yeah.
you know, clear up that question as well.
I think our mission is to not only enhance the business community, but to overall enhance the tax structure within, you know, the revenues of the town of Scituate. Can't even say the town. Tongue-tied there. So in order to do that, one of our biggest pieces of our town revenue comes from residential taxes. If we're going to compete as a town with Hingham, with Marshfield, and so on, we need to look at what residents would be coming in to look at. They're going to be looking at the schools as probably the number one. Now, I can't say for certain that they're number one, but that's why it's also, you know, the quality of life, it's the businesses, it's what does this town offer, what are the different services. And, you know, that's why you also try and get at the strengths. The weaknesses. We've got the strengths of the beaches, the oceans, and so on. So we want to make sure that we understand those. And when we're moving forward, you know, to understand, okay, what are our strengths?
we want to work on some weaknesses, we want to work on those opportunities, we need to make sure that we're all in agreement with what the strengths are so we're not hurting any of those. So that's why you ask those questions in terms of strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, threats. And some that are kind of like, I'm happy with the current state of Scituate, you know, and then the schools, it's getting at the baseline. So I think it goes across a lot of different terms that you might think are getting a little bit beyond specifically business related, but that's when we're getting into the residential taxes.
Yeah, I didn't think that, I never really thought of that as the mission for you to increase the residential tax base. That wasn't what I thought you were going at, but I don't know what everybody else, I mean, I don't, Mr. Murray?
I can see your point, you know, to be candid with you. I would prefer to see it maybe addressed as, if we're going to attract businesses to this town, those businesses are going to have people working there. What are those people going to be looking for in town? One of those things would be obviously a good school system, and you know, all the real estate agents, they have all that information right there, because as you know, anybody moves into town, they ask about the schools. But other things are also very important, and you know, I'd like to see some of those other things addressed as well. The schools are given a lot of impact in terms of the numbers of questions about them in here, which is, I think, speaking to Mr. Norton's point as well. So I would really recommend you get school feedback.
Sure.
Feedback as that word,
absolutely.
You know, and you know, you've got a, you got the chair of the school committee right back there listening in on this. But I would like to see also other issues brought up or other infrastructure, you know, mentioned along those lines. And I think Tricia's been having some conversations with you about that as well.
Right. And, you know,
and then address
that,
it that way. I mean, because as Tony says, excuse me, Mr. Vignani says, you know, at least I didn't envision that we were asking you to somehow increase the residential tax rate or the tax contribution, because that's plenty high as it is. In fact, it's way out of balance. We're asking you to increase that other 4 or 6% to be much bigger. But I understand how obviously schools figure into it because it's part of the town and all that sort of stuff. So I see that point, but I think getting at it from a more, from an angle that's more focusing on increasing businesses, and those businesses have employees, so they're interested in schools, they're interested in the harbor, they're interested in the West End, they're interested in water, they're interested in that stuff.
That's our primary focus.
That's a point well taken.
Yeah, you don't want it to come across like we're trying to get, make every house a McMansion in here to increase the tax revenue. So that's what you want to kind of.
Okay, that's helpful.
I think dance around.
I agree with that.
See what I mean?
Yes.
Any other comments on that?
I don't know how you're gonna go through the different.
I'm gonna follow you. You're the leader.
I'm not the leader, but I will speak first. I'll take the lead on this. Just a couple of, and I don't mean this to be humorous in any way.
Are you looking at any one in particular?
Yeah,
you
I'm gonna be
with
looking. I'm gonna
one?
Be looking. All right, we'll start at the. All right, I happen to have the business.
They kind
one.
Of all build on each other, which is.
Maybe I could do the residential one first.
That's the shortest.
I guess I, you know, some individual questions, I'm happy with the current state of Scituate schools. That type of question is, you know, I guess I don't see a lot of connection there to, and I know you explained it, I still have a problem seeing the connection between that and what I consider economic development. But, you know, you can, the other thing that I had I guess nothing else than that.
There was a page missing, I think, in one of these.
The resident.
That I on page questions 6, 7, and 8.
Page 4.
Which is one that, I mean, I guess I can bring it up, the restaurant revenue.
Yes.
The question on that, number 8. And actually, I think if you look at one of the other surveys, you can see it on the other one. Somehow, what I want to get across in here is that the town for the last couple of years has chosen not to do this.
Okay.
You know, we We talk about it every year. We discuss whether we want to have that, and I spoke with Bill about this as well. And it's not something that we won't probably discuss at our next retreat as well, but it's something that we've chosen, and we do actually look at. It's not something that has been overlooked, and it's like, oh, wow, that we can charge a restaurant tax. You know, that's not the case here. So somehow you should get in there that it is reviewed, but it is something we should consider. You know, maybe we have been a little bit off base in thinking that the residents don't want another tax piled on top, and that, you know, mostly Scituate residents eat in the Scituate restaurants, but this would be good feedback to that. But I just make sure it comes across that, you know, that it was there, it was known, it is discussed, and what's your flavor for it now? And as you've mentioned in here, it has grown, it's doubled in the last couple of years. You know, when we first looked at it, it was $70,000. Then it came in at $118,000. And now last year it came in at $193,000. So it's growing to be a number that would have more of an impact on what it could do for the town. So that was my, anyone?
This is on both the business survey and I think the employee survey. It's on the business survey anyway. Question 13, weaknesses of the town, and 14, the threats of the town. And I don't mean this to be humorous at all, but on the third column, Irish heritage is a weakness and a threat. Now, I know we haven't done everything right, and sometimes we don't make great decisions, but please explain how Irish heritage fits into a weakness or a threat.
I wouldn't explain that it would fit under any of those. What I did here was all of the choices for a strength, a weakness, a threat, or an opportunity are the same.
I guess I'll follow up
on
that.
If I went through and took out under weakness or threat, I took out Irish heritage, then I could be gearing, people could accuse me of trying to guide their answers.
Okay, well,
so
maybe
I'm not disagreeing.
Yeah,
with
maybe you can explain to me then
why
it's in
there
at all. You know what I mean? Yeah,
Jen,
I just don't understand.
Jen, I think
we should take it off altogether.
I think when you start getting into ethnicity, they can create a whole host of issues. And I think, and I'm not looking at you, but I'm like just as a general, anytime you begin to get into that type of stuff, somebody will be offended by it. Maybe they should be. Maybe. I think the best thing to do is
to take it off.
Okay.
And I'm also, I don't want you guys to feel,
we
took
don't.
A lot of these, it has kind of like grown over the time. A lot of these came from different surveys in different towns. And so,
don't worry.
You know.
I think it's just wise to say,
I was
going to
suggest
that
you
out.
Put
that
Italian in
gone.
There next to it.
Yeah, let me know what town had that in there, will you?
Yeah, but having said that, I absolutely support the fact you have to have the same boxes on all three.
Thank you.
Okay.
But take
that's there.
But what
but that one you can take out of all of them.
I'm taking that off of all of them.
But you have to have them all be the same.
Now, if you say, are you a Yankee fan or a Red Sox fan, you know, maybe.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. That's all I have for right now.
Take Tony,
you.
To follow up on your meal tax thing?
Yes, Rick.
If I may. When you say, would you be in favor of the 3/4% meals tax in Scituate? And you give three options. One is yes. Mm-hmm. One is no, and comment on why not. And then the middle one is yes, and please earmark the funds to support economic development with a capital E and a capital D in this town. I think that's really, I would just delete that whole middle box, my personal feeling, okay? Because one could argue what economic development could be across the whole spectrum, right? I mean, any one of these things, people could get into what really is denominated by the phrase economic development.
And that idea came up when we presented the service to the planning board as a way, and I probably should say Economic Development Commission, as a way of trying to help fund a budget, you know, for this, you know, to do things like maybe on their website. But we'll take
it's our budget.
Okay. Point taken.
Yeah. Okay. Any other comments on, well, we're again, they're kind of all in all the surveys, so.
Yeah, and it does get tricky of which ones are in which, and then when I had to go back and do, you know, the updates to them, it does, because now they're
I think it was great.
Suits.
I think the surveys, Rick, did you want to follow up on?
This is just a pet peeve, I'm going to say, and it's,
are you male or female? Shouldn't the answer be yes? As opposed to male or female?
But I'm pumped.
Are you?
Okay, any other questions on the tax? Excuse me, the restaurant tax? No, we're all pretty, talked about the school stuff. I guess it was, one of the themes came up on the buildings, and again, if anyone has any comments, you know, we talked about buildings in terms of elementary school buildings, middle school buildings, high school buildings, and then we take all the rest of the buildings, all the 52 other buildings,
yeah,
and throw them in a town, other town buildings. So somehow, I mean, even if it just said school buildings and town buildings, but, you know, some people may love the fact that the Cudworth House is the way it is, but hate the fact that Town Hall is the way it is. So you may want to pull out some of the more highlighted town buildings and isolate them, or roll up all the school ones into one as well.
I did write historic buildings separate than town buildings,
right,
separate than the schools. Is there another category you think that we could add there, or?
I mean, maybe talk to Al or Tricia in terms of what buildings you may want to, I don't know, Tricia, do you have any thoughts?
I think in the school section, you list every single school, and then there's sort of that catch-all for town buildings. So maybe it could be public safety.
Okay.
I know library, town hall,
yeah.
I think the Maritime Center is one that particularly interests.
Pier 44.
John, did you? Yeah, I was just going to say, you know, when you're looking at like community building or public safety, you know, the fire station, possibly new town hall, you know, recreation type of facility. I mean, if you're going to put it out there, then kind of like a shotgun, throw it out there, because people might begin to say, well, what about this? What about that? That's all.
Rick, yes.
Along the theme of buildings and facilities, one a year in the SWAT. Across the board, as you say, the lack of management of town facilities.
I added that Tuesday night.
Yeah.
Well,
you saw, well, this board certainly feels that we need to enhance the management of town facilities, but I think you can get your point across by just saying management of town facilities.
Okay.
And letting the individual decide whether it's a strength, weakness, opportunity, or threat, as opposed to cooking it towards the lack. And I know that's your intent.
Better.
I know that's
yes.
your intent, but there's some wordings in there that kind of creep in occasionally. Yes. And if you just go through each one without having us, you know, keep it on the objective side.
Yes.
And I know that's entirely your intent.
No,
so.
That okay. is very helpful.
We're with you on that. I can tell you that.
Yeah. If I just may make a comment while it's in my head, a lot of times it's obvious tonight. You come in and we're just suggesting changes, and don't take it in any way as a criticism. It
yeah.
absolutely is not. I mean, I am so happy that you people are in place. I think we all are. It's something
right.
that we've been aiming for a good number of years. So, believe me, it's we thank you very much for stepping up and taking this job. And any corrections we make are just corrections that we, over the years from experience, might have garnered. So thank you for doing it, and we really appreciate it.
It's thank what you. I call a violent agreement.
Yeah. I mean,
go ahead.
Well, I was just going to just quickly, like another one, the lack of affordable housing. We actually have affordable housing. And so you could phrase that by saying the amount of affordable housing. Because lack is a judgment and the amount is a fact. Whether the amount is enough, or the amount is too much, or the amount is just right, let the survey responders decide that in which box they check it off. So, you know, that word lack can be a problem. Well, no, there's some cases it's true because there isn't a shuttle bus. So
diversity is gone.
That's true. So you know what I mean?
Lack of taxi service. I mean,
yeah. Just be careful of wording. And to echo Joe's point, you know, this is all constructive point because we really are. This is great.
No, this is very helpful.
Yep.
We're new at it and appreciate it.
Sean?
Jen, did you say you got some of these surveys questions from other towns? Did you see the results?
Yes.
On the business survey, what would be some of the answers? I was just scanning through them, and this one kind of jumped out.
That's a good question.
What do you think the town could do to help increase the profits
of your business as you're filling this out. What were some of the answers? I mean, I, you know, do you recall any?
It's a great question. I don't recall any.
All right, okay, all right.
I could go back and find out for you.
No, that's not that important. I just kind of jumped out at me and...
Some of the things that we've seen, and again, we've...
That's what I was wondering.
...a group of surveys, and from my experience on a similar commission where I originally grew up, it was some of that public-private partnership, and I think I mentioned that when I was here once before. It was specifically the private group put together, unlike the Economic Development Commission, which is much more town-oriented. There are ways that we've seen groups essentially market from a very personal standpoint, you know, meeting with folks on a breakfast, and we can have the whole group together without having to worry about the town meeting law, the open town meeting.
A chamber of commerce type? Is that what you're talking about?
It's a little chamber of commerce type, but it's, but you can offer, you know, I wouldn't say incentives, but there's ways that I've seen, whether it be from an educational standpoint or businesses working together to try to bring additional businesses into town. Again, that would be good. And I see the chamber has a great website. It's a little...
Live, work, and...
Live, play, work, or work, live, play, and it's things like that we've seen websites built out. We've seen other towns where they're quasi-public websites where it attracts. And if you are looking to potentially move a business, to be able to either come through a group like that or the town's representative via the town administrator to have an off-the-record conversation, find out what's out there, what's available, what space might be out, and put them in touch with a realtor.
Good.
A lot of that we're not even able to do, or cities and towns I've found, at least when I've been involved, haven't always been able to achieve that with a commission like this. And that's why we're, you know, we'd love to look at that and explore that at some point. We have someone on one of our subcommittees, if you will. In fact, it's one of the individuals who wasn't chosen, who is actually eager to help us do that. And again, that's something we're looking at. You'll all be involved, but it's... those are the things that we found that some of the other towns have done.
Great, thanks.
Just, and I know there's a question on one of the, maybe in all the surveys. Somewhere down the road, you will, I'm guessing that, come back with suggestions as to zoning, et cetera. That's...
It probably won't be soon.
Oh, absolutely. I'm not looking, you know, maybe it's a final report, or if there is a...
We hope there won't be a final
report. Yeah, not a final report, but...
Dialogue. We'll report up through the Board of Selectmen twice a year.
Okay.
We report through the Planning Board four times a year. We've already had one meeting with the Planning Board, and we did meet with the Chairman and Selectman Danny recently, just to kind of give them an update as to where we were, you know, Tony being Chairman and John being our liaison, and we will be up in front of you to talk about some of the initiatives. I know that Trish and Jen had a discussion with Tricia last week, 2 weeks ago, I think it was. I meet with Tricia tomorrow morning to go over what some of our specific initiatives are.
Good.
And, you know, when you mentioned zoning, we all know there's a long, drawn-out process to do any type of rezoning. That's part of what we call our 3A initiative. And we think there's some great opportunity there. The Chairman of the Planning Board agreed with us on the whole Route 3A opportunity. He called it spot on. So those things we'll bring back through both the Planning Board and the Board of Selectmen and the Town Administrator.
And that's great, I think, because we can determine what the town can do to help individual business. We can determine through surveys what type of businesses people want. Maybe even what type of business would be willing to come to Scituate, but we have to have a place to put them. Mm-hmm. And right now, you know, we don't. I mean, if we get, you know, overwhelming response tomorrow from all sorts of industries and businesses, we'd be faced with a problem. Maybe a good problem, but a problem. And that's what I think that may be a biggest challenge when all is said and done, is to figure out, you know, how we can look at zoning and maybe take. Change it in different areas to accommodate what you're able to find out over the next period of time. So,
and as Ken said, Selectman Norton, this is a baseline. So we'd
yep.
like to find
yep.
out what the town residents,
yep.
the town, the businesses, as well as the stakeholders, the employees in town, think. We're going to find that out, but each year we'll find out, is there an appetite for rezoning?
Yep, I don't know. That's a good question. That's exactly what I'm trying to... You might have to do this first, this type of groundwork first, before you can get to that level, but...
That's exactly.
Any other?
Just Jen or Trish or even Bill, when you said you got a number of responses from the town of, I think you said Framingham, and then also Bolton and Walpole, was there a percentage? I ask that because, you know, and again, given the demographics of the town and the expectation of the people to respond, I'm not too sure if you should be overly excited that you're going to get a number of responses. But based on those towns, did you get some kind of like basis, like a percentage as to what their response was as your baseline going forward? That's all.
I did not. I don't know about off the top of my head those town-specific response rates. I do know the Pier 44 study had over 1,000 respondents. And historically, you know, being the statistical person that I am, 30% response rate would be fantastic, like through the moon. But if we get at least 5 or 10%, we will have a statistically sound response rate that we can use the data and say, this is valid.
Gotcha. Okay.
Is there a way so that someone can only fill it out once? Do you have that in the...
We've talked about doing potential surveying of the businesses and the employees and residents, because we're not going to be happy or comfortable, I think, with 5 or 10%. We'd love to get the same response rate or more than Pier 44 got. We have talked about informally, we haven't voted as a commission, but we have talked about informally to go out to folks if we don't get a good response rate via Survey Monkey, and we'd ask, you know, we'd be straight up, did you go online and fill this out? If you didn't, we'd love to talk to you. I think we'll get both, you know, the boxes filled out, but we get some great dialogue with folks as well. For those folks who, you know, if we have to send, can we send it out twice? I think Pier 44 went out a few times. So if we...
I guess my question was, can one person fill it out 30 times?
All-star balloting.
Yes.
Yes. So that may be...
That is something that I'll be able to tell.
There's a key, though. Yeah, because you'd be able to see the ID.
Right.
Oh, there's an idea. Okay.
I won't be able to prevent it, but I'll be able to look at the data and know if that has happened and toss it out.
Okay.
Or, you know, decide if we're going to keep any or go back. I think we'll have to deal with that on a case-by-case basis. I'm hoping there's not too many.
Yeah, I don't expect. I just, yeah.
Yeah, no, it's a good, fair point.
Ms. Burbine.
Ann Burbine, 10 Pennycuss Road, also owner, business owner of Scituate. I think one of the things that we all need to recognize, and let's take my Scituate as an example, and I spoke with this artist, and Dan, I spoke with him the weekend. In North Scituate, there are probably 5 or 6,000 businesses, but they really are only 5 property owners. Mm-hmm. And that's something I think that you really need to keep in mind, that it's fine to encourage business to come into Scituate, but often the rents from these different, there are only 5 major property owners in North Scituate. And if you look at Scituate Harbor, I will tell you there are probably 5 major property owners there as well. It's very small, that have all of these businesses, and we are at the mercy of whether or not they want to fix the roof, whether or not they want to paint the building, whether or not they want to keep the rent reasonable so that we can survive. So these are things that need to be considered along with trying to bring more business to Scituate. It's
interesting point.
Just my last comment on the survey. I know under your strengths and weaknesses, you categorize town employees. Is there a specific reason? Throwing that in there, I kind of looked at that and saying, well, you know, I think there's strength, but I mean, obviously, is there absolutely need to have that as a category?
No, I think it just started flowing from, you say residents, you say employees, and so on, so it was nothing specific.
I think what you're going to find is that it's going to be scrutinized, and if you put a question in there that can move people to think that it's, you know, some sort of opportunity to jump on something, they will. for instance, the thing Joe brought up, or would be offended by it. And that's what you want to eliminate, so you can just get real true data to play with.
Right.
I think that's what you're...
Yeah, I was going to say that might be better to...
Every town employee that you give this to may say, well, this is...
I'm offended. Am I a weakness? And then they turn around, yeah.
I guess we were thinking, Selectman, Danny, the issue was there are people who come to town every day to work. Some spend 30, 40, 50 hours. And we just thought they were, and Jen used the term stakeholder. Anyone who sits on a board or commission, though, typically is a resident. So we do cover that, but we just thought there'd be other, we thought were stakeholders who could give us some good insight into, you know, what we might be missing or what their view is, whether it's a firefighter, police officer, or, you know, another town employee who might have a great idea or suggestion as to, you know, here's some revenue raisers that you guys might know about, or maybe no one knows about, and maybe there's a way to do it, but we don't want to leave any stone unturned. Good point, though.
I think John was referring to a choice of a strength or a weakness.
That's, I'm not saying not giving it to the town employees. There's just, there's a strength or weakness they're talking about.
Sometimes it's the way that a question is worded.
And that's what I'm saying is that,
that can be taken.
It might be.
And I never take offense at wording because I always try.
I think everybody should.
My strength is numbers and data. It's not writing.
Phil, no, I agree with that. This should be. Everybody has an insight that, you know, they can add to it, and they should be, so.
Do you have a timeframe for response?
Typical?
Industry, because our web address is when we've done them in the past, we leave them up all the long.
I thought we discussed it.
Okay.
It is pretty typical. We could go to like 3 weeks or 4 weeks if anyone felt strongly.
I didn't know if it was a benchmark. I mean, I was just asking you for the answer.
Yeah, I think 2 weeks is pretty typical, is probably the mean. And then you can push it to like 4 weeks. But if you're going beyond 4 weeks, you're not increasing the response rate. You want to give them enough time for people that are away or whatnot, so you don't shorten it to like a week. But 2 weeks is pretty typical. I will say, you know, I'm going to be away next week. So to make these changes and everything, it's going to push out our timeline, because I'm not going to get them done. So it's we'll look at getting this out, and then we almost should consider as a group whether we wait till after December.
Right. May make sense.
Which is fine.
And then the only other thing, which I'm sure the board would ask, is what are you going to do with the data? And then I think there has to be we have to be in agreement of how that data is vetted once it's compiled.
Okay. I think I would absolutely compile all the data. The reports would first, pull together the reports. You could see from this, I tried to keep the comment fields to a minimum because I know I'm going to be the one going through all of those comments, and to not take it, you know, forever to do this. So we will have reports. I will compile. I will make a summary report and summarize it and present to you. And
how was it done with Pier 44?
The same way we saw all the results before.
Okay. That's where you'd like it?
Yeah.
Are you going to be able to do multivariate statistics on this, cluster analysis, any of that sort of stuff? Good.
Yes.
Great. Yeah. So once you guys get it and look at it and mull through it, if you can give it to us before it goes anywhere else. Mr. Hayes.
Thank you. My name is I just had a statistics question, really. I mean, some of the questions have picked three out of sometimes up to 60 choices. I mean, statistically, are three choices the norm? And is that, do you think you get an accurate cross-section of just limiting it to three?
Yes.
Okay.
I think we have to. I think it's very much the norm to ask for your top three. From the different surveys that I saw done in different towns, but then also different industries. And I will say, you know, I relied heavily on doing research to other towns, because while I have a lot of background in doing surveys, the survey background is not to specifically towns. It's been within business. So I have seen it done where you pick the top three, and it's definitely statistically valid.
Great.
Good question.
Well, I am right now. Yeah.
No motion.
Okay. Yeah. Do we need it? I guess if you can take the changes that we've discussed and kind of send us the new document.
Okay.
And then we can just look at it. We don't have to meet again, and just give you any feedback back and forth. And then,
okay.
I mean, there were really only two or three sections.
We're going to reword some of the things that were discuss. We'll also meet, or at least speak with the superintendent and the school committee to talk about some of the school questions.
Right.
And then we'll get it back to the board through the town administration.
That'd be great. And if somehow you can just mark the changes, I don't know if you can do that or not, but whatever.
I'll be able to do it in the one that's going on Survey Monkey.
Right, maybe you circle, say we change.
Yes.
Okay.
We'll get your hard copy, maybe highlight where we made changes. And I think then they'll kind of stick out, like instead of a lack of affordable housing, we'll have a field house.
Right. Great. That's great.
So are we going to wait till we get this back? Do we need a motion to approve this?
So wait.
We do. So you want to wait?
Do a motion now and then.
You want a motion?
Okay.
Sure. Move the Board of Selectmen vote to approve the survey to be sent out by the Economic Development Committee contingent upon the recommended changes made by the Board of Selectmen.
Second.
Second by Mr. Danny. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. Thanks, guys. And again,
thank you.
It's tough because you're kind of the punching bag here, but we all support it a lot. And I think you're going to get a lot of very good, you know, obviously if people participate, you're going to get a lot of very interesting information that we're going to want to see where they trend. So I applaud you on the effort.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, Bill.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tricia.
Bye, Tricia. Bye, Jen.
I'm going to want to look at those multivariate stats. I want to see the multivariate stats. That'll be interesting.
Okay, we'll move on to item number 7, which is Laura Harborough. This is the grant. What is it called? New England Coastal Municipal Resilience Initiative.
Hi. You know that Scituate has been working with the towns of Marshfield and Duxbury on a project that is being spearheaded by the Regional Planning Agency to look at the effects of sea level rise and how that's going to increase the impact of coastal storms on residential areas and town infrastructure. And that study's been going on for a couple of months now. There's a draft report that's out that if you haven't gotten it, I'll make sure that, you know, Tricia and all of you get to see that. There was a workshop last Thursday as part of that project that Mr. Murray was able to go to, which was, you know, great to have some participation. And there were about 45 people there, and I think it was educational as well as kind of scientific. It was looking at the general effects of sea level rise on different landforms, on seawalls, and so on. And what the three planners, you know, myself and the planners of Marshfield and Duxbury want to do is we want to get into more of the specifics of particular areas and how they will be differently affected. I mean, for instance, I think everybody's familiar with the fields back behind Turner Road and how those used to, you know, just flood tremendously. And now there's better drainage in there, and that's, you know, that's helping. But that's just an example of how the topography in different areas leads to, you know, different types of flooding occurring. There's new technology available called LIDAR, which stands for light. I have that written down somewhere. It's a laser-based technique to get, you know, much more accurate topographic information, and that's what we're looking to do with this next grant, is to get that information for different hot spots along the coast and look at how some of the key infrastructure is going to be affected, the sewer pump stations, you know, other town facilities.
So the group, the New England Coastal Municipal Resilience Initiative, is that you and Duxbury and Marshfield?
No, that's a national group that is made up of representatives of different government and non-government organizations.
So are they going for the grant, or are you guys?
They're the ones who are offering the grant, and okay, we're the ones asking for it.
So you want to know if we support you, the initiative of the three town and planners, to try and get the $30,000 grant from this entity?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Any comments or questions?
Just want to add that the town of Scituate was very well represented. Laura was there. Jim O'Connell was one of the three featured speakers. There was good discussion. Representative Campbell was there. Several members of the Seawall Committee were there. I heartily support this. It's very good to see towns banding together, working on this. They clearly have support of the state, because the Massachusetts Office of Coastal Zone Management also spoke, and MAPC was there. And this is good as we try to figure out what's going on.
I'll let you make the motion.
Motion.
Mr. Norton?
Move the Board of Selectmen authorize the Chairman of the Board of Selectmen to send a letter in support of the Metropolitan Area Planning Council's application for grant money from the New England Municipal Coastal Reliance Initiative.
Second. Second by Mr. Harris. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. It's
thank
unanimous.
You,
Laura, thank you and good luck.
Thank you.
And Kim, will you grab?
We have a letter.
Oh, we already have it. Awesome. Back for 48 hours in your... Right on top of it. Okay. The next item number 8 is to discuss the timetable for the 2013 budget. Tricia gave us a timeline based on the charters and the bylaws and all the dates that we have to hit. And as we all know, this time of year it gets very busy.
Just the same one.
Thank you. We saving on paper?
So throw away the first page we have, Tricia?
No, it just starts in January. This starts...
Okay.
This starts last week.
It started last week.
Are we on track?
So this is what I have the board vote annually. It goes to the advisory committee chair and the capital planning committee chair. I've not heard back from him yet, but it's pretty much the same as you've seen in prior years, but it does set out the roadmap for the town, and that's all the way to the town meeting. Two changes for me administratively is capital budgets are due a little earlier. They're due November 18th this year, and the operating budget is due right after Christmas instead of right before Christmas. So, and that's really, I think, internally we need that extra time.
So, my comment, I think the February 21st date poses a conflict, so we can talk about ways to resolve that. What day do you want them all done by? By the 1st of March?
The board's budget review needs to be completed. Your last budget review would be on
or could we move that to the 28th?
No, you can't.
Why?
So we also have things.
Because it's administratively impossible to meet the deadlines of the chart on the 28th. Kim already asked me that last week when I did the timetable.
Okay,
have to have everything done by the 21st. If you want to have everything done by the 9th or the 14th and add another meeting, but it cannot be done after the 21st of February to meet the deadlines we have.
So it has to be done that vacation week.
Well, it could be done a week early.
Right.
So if we do it 1 week earlier, that happens to be Valentine's Day.
Well, we don't have to do it on a Tuesday night.
That's my next question. We could do it on Monday the 13th.
Right.
Or Wednesday the 15th.
Right.
Right. Whichever, I mean, I don't have any horse in that race, you know, but it just in theory.
Right.
So
and
why? Well, that's what I was asking. What's the deadline that you want us to have them all looked at? The 21st is the date that you want us to have all of the budgets reviewed by.
They have to be voted, right?
by the 21st.
Right, because the next week, they have to all be delivered to the advisory committee for them to do their final votes.
Yeah, I think.
It's all cyclical with the
right.
advisory and capital, that's the challenge. And the charter, which we've talked about in terms of the
right.
really difficult to meet that concept in the charter. So
we don't have to decide that tonight, but right. we can, why don't we all look at
this.
As long as we know what the deadline date is, then we can figure out how to fill in the,
yeah.
the blanks.
And along those lines, in terms of the parameters, a couple of these things you say, Board of Selectmen open warrant and Board of Selectmen close warrant. Does that mean we have a Board of Selectmen meeting on those dates?
Yes.
Okay, because I didn't, like, for example, I didn't have one on December 20th.
Right, that would be an addition, and
okay.
the hope is that will be the only item they
right.
on that
I don't
agenda.
See.
But it's a 2-week time frame, so we didn't need to.
Oh.
Yeah. No, so that's why I was just.
Where is that? Over
yeah.
here.
Second page, yeah.
Yeah. So the close on the 20th, open on the 6th. Okay.
My only other comment, Trish, was on the 24th.
Which month?
January, the schedule for reviewing the budgets.
Yep.
There's four enterprise funds on that night. And those can be cumbersome sometimes. I don't know if maybe we move one of them, switch something with maybe the 17th. You know, police and fire tend to be cumbersome too, but I just didn't know if what your guys' thoughts were. To go through four enterprise funds in one night can be a lot. So again, we don't need an answer to it, but if you
right.
can.
Right, and if you want to say, we'll put the transfer station on
the 7th. Right.
Because beautification is historical will go quicker. I mean, that's grouped that way because that's all of DPW under Mr. Bangert's.
Oh, right, right,
so
right.
That's how it's grouped that way.
Right.
That's a good point. And he's here anyways, though. I mean, we could
especially
do
if we did it early.
And yeah. some of us have conflicts with one of those particular dates. We might ask if we could move one of those
right.
off and stuff.
So I tell you, from this, why don't we all look at our schedules and see what we can do, and then we'll figure out, as you know, within these deadlines when we need to get them all seen by.
Yeah, I mean, since these are still a ways out, I mean, what I need you to do is vote the timetable tonight and say, you know, future changes you may make, so we can start rolling. And then, you know, I think once we're into the budget meeting, you'll have that flexibility in the matter of going on the time. It's mostly for advisory as well, though, because they flow right from you to advisory.
This also has the town meeting date on it.
Right, on a motion?
Yep, any other comments?
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to support the fiscal year 2013 budget timetable as presented by the town administrator.
Second.
Contingent on future changes
as amended.
Second by Mr. Norton. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Great. Number 9, the town administrator's report. Partially because of the override?
Some of it is, yeah. It's just an income increase because of the override. The tax liens, deferrals, and foreclosures are up considerably due to Jane Lupardo's good efforts. But on the other side, permits and inspections and the motor vehicle are down a little. Although all other local receipts are looking very good as compared with last year at the same time, up almost 80,000. All other local receipts include boat excise, payments in lieu of taxes, rentals, licenses, ambulance fees, fines and forfeits, and earnings on investment.
I was a little concerned at the vehicle. I mean, that's down considerably. Is that a timing difference,
yeah,
or is it?
It's all dependent on the tapes that we get from the registry. So we actually got an extra one last year, so we got a little bump. We got it late. So this year, we don't know, but we've got.
Why wouldn't that be consistent every year, Tricia? Within a week, 2 weeks, or something like that?
Because the registry issues tapes to municipalities not based on the schedule, but based on the number of vehicles flowing through, and those number of vehicles can vary widely.
Yeah, right.
In terms,
yeah,
of, we can get one tape that might have 400 changes, and we can get another tape that has 2,000. So, you know, and we really don't have any control over that. The financial team met last week. We finalized the revenue and expense assumptions for FY13. So those will be ready for when Tony, we want to schedule the financial forecast.
Right.
The team has the baseline to do that assumptions and ready to be ready for town.
So we'll have that. I know Mike was asking about that too. We'll have that meeting either next week or the beginning of the following week.
Yeah. But I can send you all the revenue assumptions that we do in the budget book, so if you can head start at least, and then we'll hit the ground running when we meet. And
great. Any questions on that? All right, number 10.
Mr. Chair, we have a resignation from the Water Resource Committee. It's by Bob Murray, no relation to me, but I've worked with Bob on the Water Resource Committee for a long time, and he's been there from the Water Study Committee days. And so his letter reads, "Gentlemen, I regret to inform you I must resign from my position on the Scituate Water Resource Committee. Due to the demands placed on me by my business, I no longer have the time necessary to adequately support the committee. I've greatly enjoyed the 8 years I've been associated with it, and I believe that Jeff Rosen has done an outstanding job as committee chair, and I've seen much accomplished. I'd be honored to serve the town in some capacity in the future as time again permits. Sincerely and with regrets, Bob Murray." So with that letter, I'd like to move that the Board of Selectmen vote to accept Bob Murray's resignation from the Water Resource Committee, and further that the board thank Mr. Murray for his years of service to the committee and town.
Second. Second by Mr. Harris. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And Kim, can we... do we have a letter or something?
Yes.
Yeah. He's been a real good guy on that committee.
Number 11 is new business, other business?
Tony, I've said this every year, and I'm going to steal John's thunder here. But, you know, it was just amazing. I had to be out in my van last. I was doing a service call, and I had to go down to Brook Street. It was just getting dark. So I figured I'd go down to Maria's from, you know, Driftway, turn left. John, it's just a credit to those businesses in the harbor. There are probably more children down there with smiles on their faces than the St. Patrick's Day Parade, Heritage Day, the Carnival. I mean, it's just awesome that the merchants, you know, do that. And a lot of these kids probably come from out of town, you know, and it's just a great event for, you know, you guys have the kids that age. And they think that's it. So you maybe go to a couple of neighbors, and that's it. You guys are done early, you know. So it's enjoy it while they're young. But it's just a credit. Tricia, have you seen anything like it before? Oh, it was just unbelievable. The cars were everywhere, and there were kids running in every direction. It's just a credit to this town, and more importantly, to the merchants for doing what they do. You know, it's awesome. That's it. That's all I have, Tony. Sorry, John.
Nothing. Well, I just want to sound in that, you know.
Follow up on it.
I just want to just elaborate a little bit more. You know, people don't realize that, you know, it's a signature event for this town. And you go downtown, and you see all the kids, the merchants, the Scituate Police Department. You know, this is all donated by them. The Scituate Chamber of Commerce. You know, the merchants and the store owners, you know, it's like $500 minimum. Could be up to $800 worth of candy that they're handing out. And you know, I just would encourage everybody to go and frequent the businesses. That's right. That's really the whole point. They don't have to do this, and during this economic time it's very hard. And so, you know, if you got an opportunity, instead of driving out of town, go down there, go to North Scituate, just try to shop within your town. And And it's a really wholesome event, and you're absolutely right, Sean. I just wanted to say thank you to, again, the police, the Chamber of Commerce, the Front Street Merchants, for putting on a spectacular event, and kudos to them.
And John was dressed up last night?
As a lawyer.
As a lawyer and selectman.
Scared a lot of people away.
Running left and right. Rick?
Yeah, just one quick thing. Speaking of the Water Resources Committee, I was reminded by Bob Murray's letter. They said that they, or we asked them to come back at the end of this summer, the summer that just ended, and tell us the results of the water restrictions that we had put in with the in-lawn. And I know that Mr. Rosen was talking with Al about coming before us and giving us a report as to how it went from their water-based perspective. So they might be coming to see you to try to get some agenda.
Kim sent an email out about it just yesterday, I think.
Oh, great. Done.
The only thing I'd like to ask is, as we incorporate the water aspect of it, that we also incorporate the revenue aspect of it. So if Al can, so we can see where the lack of use of water affected our water enterprise funds revenue. Is that it, Rick?
That's it for me.
John?
Just briefly, we received a letter from Comcast, and I just want to say thanks to Comcast. You know, they're, in essence, donating about $10,800 to the high school for internet and broadband, and, you know, it's a great opportunity when businesses do that to be able to, you know, donate to town. I'm sure they're under an obligation to, shall we say, donate back to communities. But I have to say it's an opportunity that, you know, obviously it benefits our town and our kids. In that same vein, the sister company, Xfinity, has decided to increase your rates. So considering that they're giving a benefit in one vein, they're going to be increasing the various rates. So I want to thank Xfinity for doing just the same. The other issue I just wanted to raise, I thought it was very humorous to read both letters simultaneously. The other one was the duathlon. The duathlon came out very well. I commend Nico Afonseco as well as the fundraisers or the other participants who put this together. There were very few complaints as compared. This is the third year, and it was a great town event. There was a lot of hard work, again, by the Scituate Police as well as the construction company. I think it's Albanese Construction. They made sure that Hatherley Road was somewhat, shall we say, given the sewer and the water installation to make the road more, shall we say, pleasant or more convenient for the bicyclists. So I just want to say a great event. It's another signature event that the town is coming into, and I commend them for it. Outside of that, the only other thing I was going to say is we were given from the Department of Environmental Protection, we're going to be awarded about $1,200, I guess, for a targeted small-scale initiative, and I hope that we're able to use that for bins or something that's going to be green or recycling. So outside of that, that's it.
Great. Again, I was at the Halloween thing last night. It was great, huge event, right at 4:30, and I saw John and a bunch of families down there. It was a great time. Just to piggyback on what John was saying about spending your money locally, there will be a number of events going on over the next couple of months for Christmas and stuff that are going to be drawing people down to North Scituate and down to the harbor. So I ask that you participate in those. And again, as John mentioned, if you're going to get up, buy a gift, go down to the harbor and buy it, or go to North Scituate and buy it instead of going to Hanover. We touched on this briefly. Gary Carlo, the veterans agent. I just want to take a second to thank Gary for all his years of dedication. He did a great job running all of the veterans events here, particularly the Memorial Day Parade and those types of things. And, you know, again, kudos to him for doing such a wonderful job. High school, thank the high school. They put on a night last week where all the eighth grade kids went in there and got to see what the different programs were at the high school, and very well run, a huge turnout there. And lastly, the sports report. Football season is into playoff time, and the high school football team's doing great, and so is the some of your local teams. So if it's sunny out on Sunday, head down to the high school turf there, and you'll get to see some really, really good local football. We get some teams that are doing excellent. So with that said, we'll move on to number 12, correspondence. I didn't see any in there. Number 13, approve the minutes.
Move the minutes of February 15th, 2011.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. So that's 4-0, Kim. Next one?
Will the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the minutes of March 29th, 2011, regular and executive session, on minutes of October 18th, 2011?
Second.
Second by Mr. Norton. All in favor?
Aye.
Again, that's 4-0, Kim. And lastly?
And finally, move the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the minutes of March 1st, 2011?
Second.
Second by Mr. Nanny. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, at this point, we are going to move into executive session for consideration, purchase, and exchange, lease, value of real estate property, and labor negotiations. So, thank you all, and have a good night.
Mr. Murray?
Aye.
Yes.
Yes.
Mr. Nanny?